Hello, everybody. It's funny, I had to wait for the video to come on to check some levels and stuff. Got Daryl McMillan, Black Corvo, Chris Sarantos, American Devil. Hello. Ben in Montreal. Justin Mabe, Kristen. Oh, Chris, excuse me. No sound yet? Yeah, the sound should be coming on. I was having a brief technical difficulty there. We have video, we have sound. Sound should be good, right? Can everybody hear? Let me check my audio mixer. Testing. Now it should be sound. There it is. Okay. MB215. Yeah, late night tonight. You know, I was going to fire up a little bit earlier this evening, but I actually ran into some technical difficulties. I was getting a buzzing sound on my board over here, my floorboard that's off the ground so everybody could see what it is, and I was getting some odd buzzing, and I checked every cable, and it turned out, I don't know why, when I had the effects loop on and I had some stuff in the effects loop using the same power for the front of the amp and the effects loop, just gave me a buzz, maybe like a ground loop or something. So I took the pedals that were in the effects loop and gave it its own power source, and then I had no problem at all. So I don't know why that happened. So I know it's not Friday, but this is really kind of sort of, I'm an hour and 15 minutes late, but this is the last Friday of the month. So it looks like a bunch of us didn't forget that, because we're all here, we all hanging out and having some fun, and cheers. Dan Benkert, what's going on, man? Black Corvo. Yeah, it's kind of weird because all of this stuff is actually on the same circuit. So I don't know how that happened. But yeah, likely a ground loop. It's really just, sometimes it's just a function of figuring it out. You know, I've been, I subscribe to the guitar magazines and I see these crazy meticulous pedal boards where like the wires are like clipped into and screwed into the wood, and it's like, what happens when they have a problem? Like, what do these people do with the boards that are so tight, and you get a bad cable or a bad connection or a ground loop where you need to switch things around? What do you do? That's what I always wondered about these really tidy pedal boards, you know? Drinking the same thing for the umpteenth time. Yeah. Yeah, went to a Target and got some of these Snapples and some Liptons. I may go over to Lipton later. Black Corvo, yeah, man, dude, I love the amps that you put together and stuff, man. You do a nice job. So Black Corvo in the chat, go check out his videos. Guy builds amps. Vibro Steve, Dan Benkert, Carlos Harquin, the almighty Antichrist. Mark Shields, greetings, earthlings. So, I was doing a little traveling. You know what? Are we cool if we start with a story? I got to start with a story. Okay? We're going to start this show with a story. So, I was traveling this week. I think a lot of folks know I have a day job. This isn't my livelihood here. The old joke about musicians, you know, what's the difference between a musician and a large pizza pie? The answer being the pizza pie could feed a family. You know, the musician can't. You know, there's that joke. I wouldn't have what I have if I didn't have a job, because if I depended on my music, I wouldn't have anything. The typical starving musician. Steve Renimbo, Dan Parker, Robert Kelly, Mark Nagel, Terry's GG&G. Yeah, man, it is kind of late. Not that late. Usually I do a 2 minutes to midnight on a Friday, so I'm an hour and 15 minutes late to my own show. I was really focusing on trying to solve a problem. I had a humming problem. And what was really bizarre, too, when I put my tuner on, I was hearing it through the effects loop. It was just bizarre. Yeah, Mark writes, my pedal boards are always a mess. So let's start with a story. So a because I was really, for the first time in a long time, I had an amazing experience in a music store. When was the last time you had an amazing experience in a music store? Honestly, after this video, because if you're live, you can't write in the comment. It's only a live chat. But if you're watching this video and there's a comment section below, I want you to comment. When was the last time you had an amazing experience in a music store? Okay? Mine was this past few days. So I went to a place in Maryland, Chuck Levin's, I think that's the name, Chuck Levin's Music Store. And a buddy of mine took me over there. He's a bass player. He's from the area and said, you got to check out Chuck Levin's. And I'm like, you know, I heard of that. And we went in and wow, I was blown away. Most music stores, and I'm generalizing here, when I say most, my local Guitar Center, the small mom and pop shops, you know, small mom and pop shops are cool, but usually they don't have the funds to stock it all. And then the Guitar Center have the funds, but it's very narrow. You know, a lot of cheap crap, right? Chuck Levin's in Maryland. If you ever have an opportunity, go to Chuck Levin's in Maryland. It will blow your mind. They had every amp from inexpensive to super expensive and everything in the middle. They had Diesels. They had Engels. They had Friedman's. Marshalls, although they had Panama. They had, like, the only place you typically find Panama is online. They had a Panama section. They had an amazing selection of guitars from Ibanez guitars, PRS guitars, Fender guitars, Gibson guitars, Jackson guitars, like all the good stuff too. They had salespeople there actually helping people. You know, like the guy is sitting down playing the guitar and the sales guy is like kneeling down, moving the, showing him the pickups, you know, and how it works. And I'm listening. I'm just browsing and I'm listening. And I'm like, wow. Like, I can't tell you the last time I saw a sales guy get down on one knee and show the customer like all the different pickup options and pickup selections. And, you know, he was talking about this neck is different than this neck, and he was pulling down different guitars, and I'm like, you know what? They're really earning their business. And they're not only earning their business, they're making customers happy. Like they're genuinely trying to do right by a customer. I was blown away. I was really blown away. I haven't seen anything like that in ages. Okay? And the store was packed. Right? The store was packed. There must have been about 5 employees in the guitar department helping customers. There was a lady in the front ringing people up. There were people online buying things. It was amazing. It really was a throwback to Sam Ash back in 1985. It was a throwback to like 48th Street in Manhattan when all those stores were jammed with people and there were people there trying to help you. I was really blown away. Chuck Levin's, Maryland. If you have an opportunity to go check out a really cool music store, I would strongly recommend it. And I'll be back. And you know what? I might buy something from them because it was really just an experience I needed to share with you all. Because, you know, most of the times, going into a guitar, and I have nice guitar stores here. Like I have Russo's in Jersey. Russo's in Jersey is a nice guitar store, but it's, you know, you walk in, it's very quiet. Half the time, there's no one there. There's like 2 guys behind a counter who are friendly. There's no foot traffic. And you know what? Usually no foot traffic means, you know, probably a lot of people aren't spending money there, and which means that the selection isn't huge. Chuck Levin's, huge, huge selection. And Dan Benker says on his site right now they have everything. Let me tell you something. I went on the website after I visited the store. The website doesn't have half of what's in the store. Okay? And let me tell you something else. The tickets, the tags, I couldn't believe some of the prices that I saw. Okay? So like the website, they have like map minimum advertised price. You go into the store, you will get an amazing deal. Okay? Really just an amazing place. So Dan wrote, Bill's Music in Catonsville, Maryland is amazing also. Charles Beckett in the house. So Schumanati, yeah. Manny's, he said, I wish I had a chance to go to Manny's. Some serious guitar heritage there. So this place was like Manny's. If you've ever been to Manny's on 48th Street before Sam Ash bought them, it was very much like that. It was, they had everything. People running around, servicing customers, people getting help. It's like one of those, hey, is there someone here that could help me? It's like, as soon as I'm done with this customer, I'll come over and help you. It was that busy. I was blown away. I was really blown away. And I needed to share that story with you guys and gals. So there's the nice story of the day. I'm going to have a sip now of my tasty beverage. So, yeah, there it is, chucklevins.com. And you could tell him I sent you. It's funny, I just went in as a consumer and didn't, you know, just browsed around. But I'll tell you, if you go there, tell them this video sent them because, you know, it would be nice for them to hear, you know, how organic, you know, this community is, you know. What time is it in Jersey? It is 1:27 a.m. I wanted to do a live webcast tonight. I'm not really into announcing it like I used to. The numbers typically are the same whether I announce it or not. I think everyone gets notified. And I wanted to do the live show, but I got caught up working on a ground loop that I had. And, you know, I was really just focused on getting that done because, you know, you don't want to do a demo with a ground loop. In fact, the last video I did, I had that loop, but I turned the noise gate way up and unplugged a few things, but I didn't want to do that. I wanted to not have, you know, just really good, a really good clean signal. Yep, Mark Shields said, it's good to know there's one left. There absolutely is. So with that said, I've really been enjoying... I've been enjoying the acoustic a lot, actually. And let me move the microphone over a little bit so you could see the guitar. It's funny. A lot of times I'll just leave guitars down here in the Tone Lounge or in my office upstairs. But I brought this one to my bedroom. And I was playing for my wife and my 8-year-old son last night, and they were enjoying it. We were playing a little Bon Jovi. We were playing a little, I was trying to learn a little Ed Sheeran, which was fun. And I was trying to play a little Foo Fighters and all that stuff. So let me give you a quick little... just tune it real quick and I'll give you a little sound sample. Thank you. So, doesn't that sound great? This, just really enjoying this guitar here. Let me tune it back up real quick. The Fishman tuner right on there, which is nice. You want to hear something really cool? Let me do this real quick. I'm going to plug it into, you know, I have a Vocalist Live over here. And let me play something for you real quick so you could hear it with the pickup. Hang on. Last acoustic song, and then we'll get a little metal here. One more, let's check it out. Clipping there a little bit. So, what do you think? Doesn't it sound great? A little dusty. But just, you know what? Oh, by the way, this is Ebony. I was right. On my last live webcast, I went to the website and I was like, wow, in East Indian Rosewood. Sure is dark for East Indian Rosewood. And then I was talking to the guy at Framus and he was like, dude, that's Ebony. I'm like, I thought so. Because it is stunningly black. Burnt Gerbil says, low E, 4-5-7, then E. Ah. I think I did. I did 4. Something like that. Steve from Boston in the house. I'm telling you, different guitars inspire you to do different things. I'm so happy Pixie Licks is here. Charles Beckham is here. 48 Diamond T. Did I say Pixie Licks or Steve from Boston? I have to apologize. I am so used to calling him Pixie Licks. Steve from Boston is here. Pixie is dead. Zed's dead, baby. Remember that? Zed's dead. Let's get some electric guitar going on here. Hang on. Let me unplug this bad boy. That probably hurt your ears. Sorry. I'm sorry. So it's funny. Some people said, dude, it looks fretless. It's not fretless. It has this wicked cool fret protector, which has like some foam, and it just sits right under there to protect the frets from the strings, which is nice. Troy Frost says, Pixie, when are we going to do another show, buddy? That means I got to get up to New England. Actually, I'm going to be in New England in a couple of weeks. Maybe we could figure something out. I'm going to be in Boston, though. I still didn't tune this yet, by the way. But look at this. I want you to appreciate what we have going on here. I also want you to think about how they finished this guitar. That's painted. The grain is painted. So if they paint the grain first, and then they put black, like, how are they doing this? Look at the back. Look at the neck joint. Tell me that is not, like, just stunning. See that? Look at this. Just giving you the good old visual. Oh, interesting. It says it's sandblasted. Look at that headstock. I mean, it's just, I don't know. It's like, so, you know, I think less is more. You know, this is less is more. Says the cow's okay, but the carb is awesome. I'm telling you, yeah, I mean, it's. All right, let's tune this puppy up and let's make some noise. I love reaching for the trem that's not there. In the Blues, what's going on, my good friend? By the way, I'd invite you guys on, but I'm using the Sling Studio. It's funny, I'm using the Sling Studio just for the better camera. I don't even have a two camera setup right now. But, you know, it's got the aux input, the better camera. So unfortunately, I can't invite anyone to join me on here, but I'm glad you're all hanging out. So I have a question. Steve from Boston or In the Blues, what do these two do over here? I think this is like doing a three-way, like in phase, out of phase, something like that, or parallel series. Because I have two dip switches, and I'm not sure what they do. But I can hear the difference if I'm on the bridge pickup. Like, let's see if we could hear the difference here. So right now, this toggle is upward. I'm going to kill the mic. Just pay attention to the toggle. It's a three-way toggle for each pickup. So check it out. I don't think it's a coil tap because when I tap it, the coils are active all the time. So I'm not sure. Maybe series parallel. Terry Bear says series parallel split. Maybe something like that. I'm not sure though. So what did I miss? Black Corvo, I missed what you said. Can you repeat it a few times so I could see it, please? Almighty Antichrist says, according to Volo website, series, coil, tap, parallel, each pickup. Okay. The other would be phase instead of parallel. Anthony says, watching live from the Las Vegas Strip with about 20 people in a hospitality suite. All right. Check the middle selector for phase. Yeah, I don't know. Here we go. It's funny because the middle has like you could hear, you know, like the like a single. The middle sounds like a single coil. We'll be right back. I'll tell you, it's really just, it's a phenomenal playing instrument. Devin says, love the tone in your stream. Thank you, dude. Thank you. Yeah, let's get a little clean going on here. Here we go. Some clean. So Timothy says, oh wait, who was it? Devin says, great clean tone. I see why Alex Lifeson uses H&K. You got me wanting to play a little Alex Lifeson, so let's try this out.
We'll be right back.
That's what happens when you forget the notes to the song. So, there's a couple of questions about price, and you know, I worked out an arrangement with Vola on this, so my price is going to be different than your price. So to be very fair, honest, and transparent, I don't have the street price on this, and I apologize for that. But, you know, and that happens a lot of times when I work with a manufacturer. They have artist pricing. They have different type of pricing, which, you know, the artist pricing, I guess, is the best way to explain it. So I don't know what the street price is. But if someone finds out, or I could ask and leave it in the comments section. I just don't know to answer the questions that are showing up in the chat. So my apologies. I'm just not sure. I don't want to quote a wrong price, and my price isn't going to help anybody. But if you are an artist and you want to work with them, send them an email, and you know, the whole artist endorsement thing, that's between you and the company. But again, I don't know what the street price is on this, so I apologize. I will tell you this. Let me tell you this about Vola. I will share with you what I know, which I think may be valuable information. So Vola is a new guitar company. Actually, let me turn the amp on standby. And by the way, we're going to do a featured write-up. My good friend Trushak is going to do a feature on this guitar. Or not this guitar, the company. Because one of the things I like to do, for those that care enough to tune into the ToneKing.com website, I always genuinely try to tell the story behind the company and the gear and all that. Because that's important to me. You know, I always like that stuff, right? So Vola is a new guitar company, and they really hit the market hard because they, and when I say hard, I mean good, you know, like big, right? Like go big or go home. They had a tremendous booth at NAMM, which was really their first NAMM, and man, they went all out. But not only did they have nice guitars, you know, the people are so incredibly friendly. I got to tell the pizza story, right? So one of the days, you know, I was hanging out because it was, you know, there were a couple of different hangouts at NAMM, okay? Vola was one of those hangouts. Framus was one of those hangouts, you know, where all the YouTube community gravitated towards. So I spent a lot of time at Vola. So the funny thing was, when I got there the one time, they bought pizza for us, which was very kind. And what happened was, by the time I got there was no more pizza. So I wound up leaving, not because they didn't have pizza, just because, you know, I was done hanging out. I was going to go shoot some more video. And when I came back later, the guy from Vola had said, "Where were you?" He goes, "I went to go get more pizza for you." I felt so bad that the next day I put it on my calendar. I showed him. I set an alarm I have to have pizza with the Vola guys the next day. That just goes to show you truly how nice these guys are. So we spent a lot of time there. The pizza story was funny, though, because the next day we all, you know, we all hung out. We all ate pizza. We all knew to be there for pizza. And it's funny. It's pizza. But it just goes to show you the camaraderie and the relationships that get built at NAMM over a slice of pizza, right? It's really just a nice thing. And I was, you know, and I told them the truth. I said, "Guys, I walked the whole NAMM. There's a lot of beautiful guitars. Don't misunderstand. But there was nothing that I saw that looked like this." And everyone knows I'm a collector. I'm not, you know, I'd like to say I'm a musician and I'm a songwriter and I'm a this and I'm a that. But really, at the end of the day, this whole thing started because I have a genuine passion for the gear and the art of the gear. When I saw this, I was like, "Oh my God, this is a gorgeous guitar." Okay. Now, with all that said, Vola has two lines to my knowledge. One of them is the Made in Japan line, which is this. This is their Made in Japan Blaze. Just look at that. Hang on, we're gonna get the light. That's the Blaze. Okay, And then they have other made in Japan, like this one over here is also made in Japan. Everyone knows this one. This is also made in Japan. It's my two Volas. Okay. And then they have the USA custom shop stuff, which I think is common knowledge at this point that Greg, who used to work at Acacia Guitars, is actually the custom shop for Vola. Okay. So just really, they hit the ground hard with you know their models and their designs, and it's just gorgeous. And I hope, I really, really hope that these guys knock it out of the park, because it's hard to innovate in a crowded market, and I feel like they have, you know, the curves, the carves. Like, look at the carves around the switches. Tell me that's not. Look at the carves. The curves, the carves, whatever you want to call it. It's just, it's truly stunning. Look at the neck joint. No, it's just, it's stunning. So that's the story on Vola, and like I said, we're gonna do a feature on them. So hopefully we'll have the whole story soon. I just need to get True Shack warm introed into the guys, because he doesn't know who they are. So I'll do a warm intro and we'll get that story rolling. And I always learn from the stories. You know, I always have someone else that typically does the write up, and you know, I actually learned from that myself, so. But that's the guitar, which I love. Really just a beautiful guitar. I still wish I knew how they did it. I don't get it, but it's something else. It's gorgeous. You know, it's funny. Who said it? Ray Mad Raj says, is that the reverse headstock model? You know, I was looking at that before, and it kind of looks like a reverse headstock, doesn't it? It's got to be. Hang on. Yeah, it's got to be a reverse headstock, because look. Look at this headstock. Let me flip it around so you could understand. It's got to be a reverse headstock, right? Yes? Do we agree? It's got to be. It's got to be. So, that right there is the Vola. So it's funny, Terry said, more like a Jackson. I'll tell you, I changed the title of the video because I was like, you know, the new Jackson. I feel like this is very reminiscent of a USA Jackson custom shop guitar. I don't know what the scale length is. I don't have my tape measure here. Probably 25 and a half. That would be my guess. Corey wants Jim Morrison. Is that do 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 do. Something like that. So it's a 24 fret. You could see the 24th fret right over there. So some questions. Yeah, so a lot of folks are asking about the scale. I have a tape measure. Let me just go get it so I can answer the question. Where's my stand? Oh, here it is. Okay, bear with me. Bear with me for a moment and I will answer the scale question. So let me throw that on standby. So let's see. What's in the comments? So someone asked if I have a PRS. I do. I actually own two PRS guitars. One of them is an S2. Would you like to see it? I could go get it. It's upstairs, but I'd be happy to go get it if you want to check it out. So Nicholas says, no visit for Jackson Charvel EVH in NAMM 2018. So, Nicholas, you know, that's a good question. The short answer is no. The long answer is, you know, when I went there, it was just insanely busy. Like, if there was a fire marshal there, he probably would have evacuated the room. So, I couldn't shoot video. So, Terry Bear is saying, still haven't gotten the shirt yet. So, Terry Bear... Philip McKnight actually ordered it. So I will text him tomorrow and ask him, But if you can, just do me a favor. You know, I think everyone knows this. I work off of email. Like, if it's not in my inbox, I forget about it. Terry Bear, please send me an email so I could remind me, and I'll follow up with Philip tomorrow to see the whereabouts of the shirt, because Philip was the one that ordered that. So please send me an email. Info, at thetoneking.com. Come straight to me. Mad Raj, you're making me laugh over here, buddy. Okay. Yeah, so Nicholas, that's the story on the Charvel. I would have, but you know what? I didn't have an opportunity to get in early. You know, I would have loved to, but, you know, it is what it is. Pacifica says, you going to the Dallas Guitar Show? It wasn't my plan to go to the Dallas Guitar Show, so no, not going to that. So let me go get, if you're interested, I'll go get the S2. Does everybody, we're in an hour. We're officially at the top of the hour, or at least the top of the hour from when I started. If you want, I could go get the S2, and if you'd like to check it out, I'm happy to go grab it. We could take a 5-minute intermission. I have to go upstairs for that. Happy to show it to you. Oh, yeah. Sammy Reynolds says, thought on Gibson's bondholders trying to push Henry out. Well, you know, I understand, you know, they, you know, here's the dilemma, in my opinion, of course. Of course, Henry owns the company, but it's like, it's one of those, who really owns the company? Who really owns my house? Me or the mortgage company, right? So, you know, I think the mortgage company, in this particular case, the bondholder, wants a change. They're willing to negotiate terms at a cost, and that cost is change. Henry, on the other hand, is saying he has met his financial obligations. You know, like me, even though I have a mortgage, I pay it. So I meet my financial obligations. His argument is, despite the debt, he meets his financial obligations. So pound sand, right? That's what I've read. But I understand, you know, there's a little give, there's a little get. You know, if you want a little something, you know, you know, it's the whole give and get game. If they're going to renegotiate terms, they want him out. And he's arguing, saying, I've met my financial obligations. So who knows? You know, I have to get this off my chest before I go get the PRS. I actually feel bad for Henry. And I mean that sincerely. The guy owns the company. I was having dinner with a friend of mine the other night. We were talking about this. And I said, you know, the guy is living with a dilemma. The dilemma is every time he innovates, he gets his teeth kicked in for it. Okay. You know, like with the Firebird X, nobody wanted it. Everybody said, you're crazy. What are you doing? Right. But he was trying to innovate. And I think what we've come to learn is people that buy Gibson don't want innovation in a Gibson. They want a straight up Les Paul. So when they build up a straight up traditional guitar, then he gets his teeth kicked in for not innovating. It's like he's damned if he does and damned if he doesn't. So the problem is, what do you do? If you own the company, what would you do? The guy, Henry, I'm talking about, has tried to innovate. He's not innovated, and it seems like no matter what he does, he takes crap for it. However, people love Gibson, and that's a fact. Whether you love him or hate him, even the haters love him. You know, the whole you hate us because you ain't us type of thing. It's true. You take Heritage Guitars. These are guys that work in the original factory. They have the original equipment. And it's not as desirable as a Gibson because it doesn't say Gibson, right? People want a Gibson. And as a result, they're very demanding and very cynical about Gibson. But I think Henry is genuinely trying to produce a product that people want and just can't seem to make anybody happy in the process. That's my opinion. So, okie dokie. Let me go get the S2. I don't think I've ever showed it to you on camera. Because you ain't us. You hate us because you ain't us. Okay, I'll be right back. Go take an intermission. go get a beverage, go use the bathroom. I am going to go get the S2, and we'll be right back. All right, so I officially have too many guitars down here now. I'm gonna pop open a nice Lipton iced tea. We're gonna get a refresh here. Everybody back? Are we good? Okay, so I own two PRS guitars, and this is my first PRS guitar. This one here is a classic electric, an original classic electric. Give you an idea of what that looks like. This has a, I think, Dragon pickups in here. Okay. Someone able to pull up the serial number, the model based on the serial number? I think maybe it's a 98. Okay. So that's the, I'll tune it up real quick. Hang on. No birds. The original Classic Electrics. So that right there, this is an original Classic Electric, an original CE. And you knew that because it was a bolt-on. But even look at the binding. Look at the binding on this. Okay. So, that's the Classic Electric. And here is the S2 standard. Also, no birds. Matching headstock. Let me tune this bad boy up. Here we go. Thank you. So that is the S2. What do you think? Do you like it? ...2016 model. Nice matching headstock. So someone said they liked the guitar, they wanted to buy a guitar. I would probably sell this. I don't know. What would you want to buy it for? You know, this isn't an SE. This is the S2. This is the USA made Paul Reed Smith. I think new, they're like 1200, 1400, something like that. But I would consider selling this one for the right price. How loud is that amp in the room? Very loud. Pretty loud. In fact, hang on. So this is now only room volume. So, Thomas Richards said, thanks for all your live shows. Thank you, dude. Thank you for the thanks. I appreciate that. This here is the Line 6 Relay G10, which I like. No wires. Play the Black Star. Alright, let's hook into the Black Star. Let me power that down. Let me bring this over here. And I just have to hook the speaker up in the back, which I'm happy to do. And let's see what the Black Star will do for us. I can't even get through now. I officially have too many guitars over here. Okay. Hang on. Is that off? All right, that should do the trick. Oh, I gotta plug it in though.
Thank you.
So, there it is. You got to hear both. Which one? What do you think? This is an old one. I think this is a 98. Look at this. I don't even think they do this anymore. Those are made in Germany. Hang on. There you go. Made in Germany. Look at the neck. Lots of beautiful guitars. Lots of beautiful guitars. So, that's all that's new and exciting. I don't know if I'd want to sell that one, 48 Diamond. You know, I've had that for a long time. It's probably not worth much. It's probably used. It's maybe, you know, maybe I get $1,500 for it. You know, it's got a 10 top on there, by the way. Which is rare for a CE. You know, on the used market, maybe it's worth $1,500. I honestly believe that the CEs they make today aren't as good as that one. You know. Well, actually, let me take that back. Let me take that back. They feel different than that one. They probably used a different... Maybe that one was hand-carved. Maybe today they're CNC'd. I don't know. That doesn't feel perfect. Just feels broken in. You know what I mean? Oh, that's funny. Hold on. This one is... That's a 2016... Yeah, I think that one is a 98. Yeah, that one's a 98. Can you tell if I gave you the serial number? Can someone tell me the year? Does someone have like a PRS year thing? Keep it. Todd Flowers says keep it. Daniel says, any kind of inlays are better than dot markers. I don't know about that. See, I would probably sell the S2, even though I got to tell you, you know, this S2 is special because I don't know if they're all like this, but this is a blue metallic mist. It was like a one-off color. And I like the standard feel. This has a very... It's almost like a Les Paul meets a Strat or an SG. It's just, I don't know, it has its own thing going on. It happens to be a pretty guitar. I love the matching headstock. And I love the, I mean, you know, it's just a nice guitar. You know? Yeah, the S2 is pretty. It's a pretty guitar, you know? Someone wants to see the Volar again. This is just... The Volar is just... this is a stunning guitar. You know, it's funny. You have pretty guitars. You have stunning guitars. 48 Diamond says, some guitars just have the sound. Indeed, they do. So you want to do something fun? I have a drum kit over there. I could put the drums. I could do a drum beat and then jam over it. What do you think about that? Should we do that? Should I lay down a drum beat and jam over the drums? I could probably add a second camera here. Hang on. If you want to see that. I could probably add a second camera, lay down some drums. Let me get this on here. Hang on. Show the yellow one behind the CE. Hang on just one quick sec. I'm going to add this. I'm going to add my cell phone as a camera. Great Vanzini asked a great question. What became of the semi-hollow with the P90s? That will be next, I promise. My biggest obstacle is always time. And I just didn't get there yet. But I will, I promise. It's sitting in a box. We could do an unboxing right now, but then nobody will see it. It'll get lost in the shuffle, being that we're on here for an hour and a half. But I'll do it. So what do you think about... All right, we're going to do the drums thing. Let me get on here. We're going to get a second camera going on. Well, this is going to be fun. Okay, let me put this over here. Bear with me. Okay, so this is what the second camera is going to look like. Okay, that is the second camera, and now what I need to do something real quick. I'm going to swap something out. Let me turn it on. Just bear with me for a second. Let me check my levels on here. Bear with me. Hang on. Okay, let me come back over here real quick. Okay, what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna do a quick drum beat. I'm gonna hit record. I could control the volume over there and then we'll jam over it. That'll be the agenda, so let me give this a go. Hang on. Thank you. I guess it doesn't keep looping. Alright, well, that was, maybe I should try hitting it again. We're gonna try this one more time, hang on. So, just having a little bit of fun. I want to go back and hear what that sounded like myself. But there it is. G. Murphy says sounds awesome. Thanks, dude. Thanks. Let's see what else we have over here. Left and right. All right, we're about almost 2 hours in. We'll go right to the 2 hour mark. Sounded great. Cool. So next week, by the way, I'm gonna have a special guest, and I'm gonna have Doug White from Jet City. He's gonna come by. We're gonna jam on some new amps. So stay tuned for that. And I think that's probably about all that I have for you today. I'm just glad I was able to get on here and kind of hang out and make some noise and make some music and all that good stuff. So if you have any questions for me, let me know on the way out. And if you want to just tell me where you're from, as the names fly by, I'll try to call you out. And, you know, wish you all a great weekend. Great Vanzini had me covered on bass. You know, I'd like to, if you're in the New Jersey area and would like to jam, I'd love to jam. You know, maybe get even a little band going, play out, that type of thing. So if you're in the New Jersey area, let me know. Send me an email. And, you know, maybe we could figure something out. But I really, you know, for my own mental health, I feel like I should be in a band and enjoy this, you know, the collaboration of making music with other musicians. So we have Pacifica from Cleveland, Devin from Toronto, Canada. I'll be in Toronto in a couple of weeks too. G. Murphy, Massachusetts. I'll be up there soon too. TNT. Always great to see you, buddy. Sid Floyd, you also have a good weekend, buddy. Todd Flowers, thank you. He's congratulating me on the Vola. Thank you, thank you. Mike Roberts from Canton. C.R. Cook, you're very welcome, buddy, from Lubbock, Texas. Great Vanzini, Oregon. Have a great night, buddy. Charles Beckham, good night from Cowtown. Corey, my thoughts on Schecter. I like Schecter. Schecter makes great instruments. Scott Evans from Michigan. Brian from Oregon. G. Murphy, I do like Vox amps. Shred Before Dead. From BC, Canada. I guess that's for British Columbia, Canada. Dale Palmer, Rochester, New York. 48 Diamond. You're very welcome, buddy. Art L. William Gary from Kansas. Watchman, nothing like jamming with others. I wish I was close to jam. Well, maybe someday. Mad Raj, of course, from California. Han Solo. Where's Chewbacca, dude? Daryl McMillan, Nevada. 48 Diamond. Corey, Watchman, Athens, Georgia, 48 Diamond from Texas, Andrew from Atlanta, and Distant, just in time to say hello. And hit the thumbs up on your way out if you don't mind. Give me some thumbs up if you dig the video. We got about 100 of us in here right now. We got 61 thumbs up. So thumbs up on the way out. And that's all I have for you. DMS in the house, buddy. How you doing? Long time no see. Long time no chat. Andrew, Danielle, Canchola. I do like the satchel guitar. I do. Corey from Corey, Montana. DMS, it's always a pleasure having you in here, man. Chewy was your nickname, Watchman. Nice. So thumbs up on the way out. Have a great weekend, everyone. I'll be around. Probably be down here making some music and all that good stuff. So thanks for hanging out on this lovely Friday night / Saturday morning. It's 3 a.m. over here, and here we are playing drums, making music, doing what us musicians love to do. So awesome. Guys, gals, thank you. Have a great one, and we'll see you all later. Thanks. Take care. Rock on.